Okay, so, well, thanks for everyone who is coming back, because now that you have suffered through the technicalities, we can really now write down algorithms relatively rapidly. I will not do it in the historical order. The historical order was that the ground states came first and time evolution came later. It turns out, however, that in many ways, time evolution is the much easier thing. And what we want to do is basically, well, the usual thing. And the question is, of course, let's assume I have the initial state as a matrix product state. That could be the result of a ground state calculation, which we will see a bit later. Or that could be a very simple MPS, which I construct by hand. Let's, for example, for a magnet, that could be a Neil state, you know, up, down, which you can write down as a MPS where all the matrices are scalars. You can try to work that out on your own. and then, because this is not an eigenstate of the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, you can look at how the Neil order is melting and, you know, stuff like this. There are several ways of doing this, because, I mean, the question is, of course, how do I write this object here as a matrix product operator? And then, of course, I'm done, because I apply the MPO to the MPS, and then I have my psi of t. So one way of doing this, and this is historically the oldest one, is to trotterize the problem. I mean, I think everyone knows how trotterization works. So what I consider as an example is the Heisenberg model of nearest neighbor interactions. Then, of course, I can write down this is a product over infinitesimally small time steps. Let's say tau is 0.01. Then, of course, I can write down this in terms of the local Hamiltonians. And then I do the step which we all know is mathematically not correct. I factorize this exponential here, and as the parts do not commute, this is, of course, only approximative. This is the first order trotter decomposition, which is what you usually use for proofs in mathematics, in field theory, and also I will use it here for the explanation of the algorithm. In practice, you use at least second order, which you get at the same numerical expense, or fourth order. And if you want to look up fourth order formulae, you can look them up, for example, in my review of 2011. The point is, fourth order, as probably many of you know, means that ultimately then the error scales as the fourth power of the small time step you take. But this is sort of like in any method that uses trotter, this is nothing specific to my field here. So the point is, of course, basically we can more or less skip that slide, because I said basically all I had. You can, of course, calculate this object which you are left over with, say the nearest neighbor one bond Hamiltonian for a small time step. This will be a matrix of dimension d squared times d squared if each of the two sides has d states. I mean, that's the usual formula of doing that. And this we already discussed. The exponential doesn't really factorize. The error is negligible as tau goes to zero. And then what you do is because the odd and the even bonds, because they do not overlap, because they commute, you can consider all the even bonds together and all the odd bonds together. And this is what we are going to do. Again, this is standard fare for everyone who has ever used a trotter decomposition. And in the old days of discretized time, quantum Monte Carlo, everyone would do something like this as well. Now, the point is now, how do we get the MPO? Perhaps before I do that, let me show what you get once you have it, is that then you would have your initial state. Then you would have a matrix product operator which acts, say, on all the odd bonds independent of each other, so you can apply them at the same time. The next step would then complete it by the even bonds. That would consist, this together would then be one time step of time tau, and then you repeat it, then you have two tau, three tau, four tau, five tau, and so on and so forth. Okay, so what we need, therefore, is simply this object here, this MPO here, and that's very simple to do. I mean, this is what we, I just said, we calculate as a d squared times d squared matrix. This is very simple. Then I rearrange the indices in this sort of like matrix in the following way, that I group the sigmas together. Here I group the outgoing and ingoing together. Here I group site 1 together, site 2 together. Then I do a singular value decomposition, just as we described it. And then basically perhaps I distribute that by square rooting the matrix S and multiply 1 square root into this W, 1 square root into that W. And then I do this reshaping business that I pull up the physical indices to talk about different matrices. And then you see you have exactly the form of a matrix product operator. This is almost trivial to do. Calculate this exponential. There's packages for that. Then SVD it after reordering the indices and then writing the result in a fancy way. And what you see is this runs, B runs, of course, over the dimension of this matrix here. It's squared and it's D squared. So this runs from, B runs over 6, say if it's a Hubbard model, would run over 16. And if it's a Heisenberg spin 1/2, it would run over 2 squared 4. Okay, so, but this is kind of no big problem. The big problem is, of course, now that you sort of like you apply this one infinitesimal time step, fine. And this is even exact. But the problem is the dimension of the matrix product state now grows as d squared, which means once you have done this, you have to compress back the state. Perhaps not for the first few time steps, because then you can still handle that. But at some point, you will have to decide to compress it back. And then you simply apply the compression algorithm. So the entire time evolution algorithm consists simply out of preparation, get hold of these guys. And this is a simple thing. And then apply the MPO to the MPS, compress, apply again the MPO to the MPS, compress again, and so on and so forth. I mean, what you can do and what many people did in the beginning in such algorithms is they would say they would keep the dimension of the matrices fixed and then compress it always down to this dimension. What we rather do and what sort of like all, I think, more advanced groups do nowadays is that sort of like you grow your MPS, then you compress it, you allow yourself a certain amount of compression error, and you choose the size of your matrices accordingly. And as we will see in a second, this will imply that they grow. And when they have reached a size that you can't handle them anymore, then you are done, then you are cooked. Nothing can be done more. Okay, so why is this gloomy remark at the end now necessary? This is simply due to the fact that, sort of like, if you have a state here which you describe well by matrices of a size uppercase D, and if it stayed like this after time evolution, that would mean that you can always compress it back down to matrices of the size D without really losing any important information. Unfortunately, and this is of course what is the size of D that you need, that's related to the entanglement in the state. And this is sort of like where we now get back to this thing that the ground states are just a tiny, a little cozy corner of Hilbert space. Time evolution, if I assume that I start from a state which can be written as the ground state of some short-range Hamiltonian, time evolution will take you out of that into the big, big, bad wilderness of Hilbert space, and this means that entanglement will grow, and therefore the size of the states you have to consider will also grow. And how bad is that? Before we do that, I will sort of like show you at least so that you don't think it's all not working, and I'm just trying to convey that in a veiled way. I want to show you the following movie. It's a really old stuff which I did with Corinna Kollert. I was my PhD student at that time, and Willy Zwerger on spin charge separation in a Hubbard chain. I mean, this phenomenon that sort of like you insert a particle and sort of like it splits into its charge and its spin degree of freedom, and they do different things. In bosonization, this is very simple to see. We wanted to see what this would look like in real space. If you say we were thinking about ultra cold atoms, you insert an atom at some point which simulates the say a spin up electron, and then you measure charge and spin density, and you will see that in a movie. Charge density is in red, spin density is in gray, and if you look at it, you will see that they move at separate velocities. So here was just the insertion. We let the movie cycle, and then you see here the charge moves apart much faster than the spin does. So I think it will now restart. And so this is what spin charge separation would look like if you really do it in real space. And the blue-green is the density of spin up and spin down, so the actual magnetization is the difference of these two curves. This had to do with checking accuracies and stuff like this. So this was actually one of the first applications of this time-dependent algorithms. And here, I mean, we would have to discuss why this is really spin charge separation, not some other phenomenon. But here, it's just now for the purpose of showing what this looks like. Okay, here, obviously, we stop the movie because you see the signal is getting so weak that experimentally it's probably no longer relevant. The question is, of course, for how long would we have been able to go on here? And in the beginning, people thought a lot about trotter and similar errors, but this is not really the problem. So the comments I want to make is, in the worst case, the real-time evolution is limited by the entanglement growth that your real-time evolving states will have. And what one knows is that there is a bound, how much entanglement one can grow. This is the entanglement of the state at time zero, and then it's limited by a linear growth. Actually, if you do a local perturbation to a system, it only grows as log t. But if you do a global change to your system, like in the sense your state is the ground state of some Hamiltonian H, and then you suddenly change to Hamiltonian H prime, and it's a global change, an extensive change in energy, then you get, unfortunately, this behavior here. Like many of the experiments that have been done in that direction in cold atoms actually, unfortunately, actually realize that bound. It's not a loose mathematical bound, it's unfortunately realized. And so what that means is, if you know, that means linear growth in entanglement means, because of this relationship, means exponential growth in the matrix dimension. This limits the range of time you have in time-evolving matrix product states, because you really hit a fundamental limitation of quantum physics. I mean, quantum states are simply more complicated than what a classical computer can handle, and we are just lucky with these ground states. If we want to do, we will need that for DMFT, for example. If you want to calculate spectral functions would correspond to the situation I insert locally a particle, and then the growth is only as log t, and the matrix dimensions would grow as some power law. So you are better off, but unfortunately you are killed as well. If, on the other hand, for example, you did an adiabatic time evolution that keeps you in the ground state manifold, then you can basically go as long as you like. There you are limited then by the numerical errors of trotter, of numerical inaccuracies. But normally, I mean, this is tough. This is sort of like you don't really have to worry that much about the other sources of error unless you do something really stupid, but because reliably that's going to kill you, not anything else. Okay, so what you can also do is the usual thing. We all know that we do, if we look at this expression here, we take sort of like an infinitesimal time evolution to infinite times, then this projects you down into the ground state. This, of course, you can do as well. There, of course, the entanglement bound is not the one which you have here, which relies on unitary evolution, which you don't have here. Here, of course, the limit is obviously the amount of entanglement that is present in the ground state you want to calculate. Many people who write as their first code a time evolution code, because it's so simple, use that for calculating ground states. That's fine. Just realize it's much slower, and actually it's not so easy to control the errors compared to the regular DMRG-like ground state search. Okay. Sort of like a side issue, which however is important, is what do you do if you can't trotterize? That would be, for example, the case if you have long-ranged interactions, and in the kind of DMFT-like situations which we will encounter, you have such a situation. You can do something which looks a bit like trotter, but it becomes numerically inefficient. What you do then usually runs under the name of Krylov time evolution. What you do there is you bring the Hamiltonian into MPO form. I already mentioned that this can be done exactly with usually small dimensions. What you then calculate is compressing, if necessary, successive powers, psi, h psi, h squared psi, the typical Krylov vectors which you know from Lanczos, exact diagonalization. How you do that, I mean, should be clear by now. Then you orthonormalize these states. You do the Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure, and then you diagonalize your Hamiltonian, tri-diagonalize, sorry, your Hamiltonian in the new basis. This was also mentioned by Kevin Ingersen that you can write any Hamiltonian in that form. And for short time steps delta tau, you can then calculate this exponential here very precisely. It's important to note you do not calculate e to the ih delta t. That's a very complicated object. What you calculate is its application to a state psi. Otherwise, it would not work, just as a side remark. So this is nice to do if the time steps can be taken longer than in the case of trotter, but of course they should not be taken too large. Otherwise you need very large h's and then you, powers of h, sorry, and then you run into other sort of trouble. This really you would have to see when actually working with it. There is no easy way of giving a rule of thumb here. But typically if you do a reasonably small time step, say 0.1, 0.2 or whatever, 4 or 5 Krylov vectors are totally sufficient to get a quasi-exact time evolution. The approximation again comes from the compression step, which is due to entanglement that has nothing to do with driving this evolution. Again, as a side remark, of course you might think, why don't I just do that in the terms of a Taylor expansion? Funnily enough, the precision you would get for the same order of h if you do this by a Taylor expansion is incredibly much lower than what you get in this Krylov. Mathematicians have, of course, shown all that, that sort of like this thing is of any expansion you do up to power hn, that this is the most precise way of doing it. It's perhaps a bit counterintuitive because you think, well, Taylor and this, what's the big difference? But somehow it makes a huge difference. We will use that. You will not see this explicitly, but the way we set up our DMFT, DMRG code, it has long-ranged interactions, and then we use Krylov instead of trotter. I would say 80 to 90% of the world's group doing time evolution use trotter. A few use Krylov. I mean, it's a bit harder to steer. Well, I would not say so, but sometimes this is the feeling. But anyways, of course, if you have the choice for a short-range problem to do trotter or Krylov, go for trotter. But if you don't have the choice, of course, you have to do that. And then it's currently the best method we have for driving the time evolution. Okay, so I already mentioned that. So, okay, now let's assume I have talked a lot about states. We have not yet learned how to find the ground state, but assume we have it, then we can do time evolution. Then we can, for example, calculate an overlap, or we could, for unitary state, that's perhaps, it might also be interesting. But anyways, phases and so, but sort of like here, we would like, for example, to see, if I think about this Neel state, how does actually the expectation value of the magnetization evolve? And this is sort of like both the overlap and this expectation value are, of course, variations on the same theme. You want to understand how do I calculate that? And can I do it efficiently? And this is something really important in the sense that this is my matrix product state. And then this here on top of it is, of course, the bra to it. I mean, because it simply consists of the A stars or M stars or whatever matrices. So this is graphically the overlap of two states. I mean, they need not be the same, so this can be the same thing. And if I want to calculate an expectation value, I simply insert the operator, say, here, wherever I want to have it. The question, of course, is, can I do this efficiently? I mean, there is, say, in a spin 1/2, there's a lag which takes two values here. So this entire thing here, where I have these arrows, I have to contract over 2 to the power L possible index combinations. And that, of course, would bring us back to exponential complexity. That's not what we want to have. And so what you do is if you write the overlap explicitly mathematically, you find out it's exactly that what I have drawn here, this contraction scheme. But what you now do is you reorder these guys, like I do it here, that I see that I can contract first the matrices which carry index sigma 1. So I contract those two guys here. This is written here. In the next step, I contract these two guys and here and here. And so I work my way through the chain in this sequence. Mathematically, it's perhaps a bit hard, and also because it's so small in the print, it's a bit hard to see how to make these steps. But in the graphical representation, it's easy. You have to contract at all of these arrows. And I say, I start out here, then next here, next here, next here, next here, next here, next here. So I move through the chain, like with a zipper. And then you can think about how expensive this is. The index here can take d values. So it's d times, you have this l times, d times l. And then when you contract matrix with matrix, this is a matrix-matrix multiplication, this costs you d to the power 3 if d is the matrix dimension. So if you do it like this, you see you have a cost that's linear in the system size, and it's cubic in the matrix size. If, however, you preferred, for example, to contract all these guys here first and all these guys here first, and then you contract here, then it would be exponentially complex. You can try and count the indices. So the take-home message here is that there are many ways of contracting it, and they are hugely different in complexity. And here you actually know that this is the best one. But you could also do something stupid, which is exponential. But this is also a nice thing because we know mathematically it has been shown that it's one of these, I have forgotten whether it's NP hard or complete. But anyways, it's a nasty problem for these higher dimensional tensor networks to come up with the optimal contraction order. You simply don't know. Okay, but this is not concerning us here. Here we know that's the optimal way of doing it. And actually this sets, as many other operations in matrix product states, this sets the cost. Everything in MPS can be done at worst at the cost of d to the power 3, where d is the matrix dimension, simply because the underlying operations are always matrix-matrix multiplications or singular value decompositions, which also go as the third power of the matrix size. So this is the cost. MPS goes as d to the power 3. And if you have an implementation where something scales as the d to the power 4 or whatever, at this point, think again. But anyways, so let's assume we have implemented that. Then we can also, for example, calculate two-point correlators, like one spin here, S plus, S minus, or SC, SC. And what then happens is you contract over all these guys here, and you see there's this contraction object, which appears, if I assume the system is so large that I have translational invariance, there is this object which pops up again and again and again and again. It acts essentially like a transfer matrix. I will not go through the proof, just say this. It acts like a transfer matrix, and its eigenvalues then determine, of course, what the correlation looks like. The consequence of that is that matrix product states can only produce two different types of two-point correlations. Either long range, because it's an eigenvalue 1, or exponentials, and because these are huge matrices, superpositions of exponentials. More precisely, a matrix product state will in general produce a correlator as a superposition of d squared exponentials. So if this is, say, 1,000 as d, then you would have a superposition of 1,000,000 exponentials. There is no way of having a power law directly. However, the matrix product state will still reproduce power laws well, in the sense that it uses the superposition of these many, many exponentials to approximate a power law. But ultimately, at a long distance, the sort of like longest surviving exponential will survive, and it will ultimately look like an exponential. This is what you will see if you plot a correlator like this for a power law system, a critical system. You plot it in a log-log plot. It will look like this on short distances, the power law, and ultimately it will go down. And if you increase your matrices so you have more parameters to play with, this behavior will be good for longer, and ultimately it would also go down. This gives you, however, a very simple way of checking how good your power law actually is, simply redoing the calculation at many different accuracies. By the way, this should also be mentioned, the fundamental way of checking accuracy in matrix product state calculations is, of course, rerunning calculations at different d, because the larger matrices contain the smaller ones as a subset. So the number of parameters you have is simply getting larger, so the accuracy can only increase. This means it's a really variational method. You are in within an ansatz class, but your next bigger matrix product states are the same thing, just more. I mean, you can always think about the big matrix like one where you only have the top left corner with entries and all the rest is zero. And then you allow these zeros to become non-zero. It can only improve. Okay, so this is how you calculate overlaps. And now I want to sort of like to lighten up the whole thing a little bit, show one application which kept me busy for quite some time because we got experimentalists involved and turned out all very well. This was about the goal in this ultra-cold atom business to create quantum simulators, and not just one which simulates ground states, but really simulates the dynamics of a quantum system. When I hear simulator, I think about flight simulators, so something dynamical going on. And in these ultra-cold atoms, you know that you have, on very long time scales, coherent dynamics. At that point, the question was, how well can the experimentalists prepare an initial state, and how can we do local measurements? That, of course, would be nice to see, for example, how a state relaxes. And the first experiments that went in this direction, done in the group of Bloch, where they created period two superlattices with double wells, where they could also stagger the potential relative to each other, and that allowed them to load patterns, also to see whether atoms sit on odd or even sides. They would not be able to say whether it sits here on an odd side or here, but they could say how many are there on odd sides, how many are there on even sides. And building on these sort of like techniques, our proposal, this was work I did with Jens Eisert mainly, was that we say, well, prepare a pure sort of like a density wave of alternatingly occupied and empty sites. Then you switch off the superlattice, then you have an atom on every second site. And then, of course, they will propagate freely. This is a Hubbard model, actually a bosonic one, because these atoms were bosons. And then they would spread out, relax to an equal density state, and we were interested in observing this relaxation behavior, which, of course, plays around a lot about this odd versus even. Just to show what can be achieved, I think here I have to, well, to lighten up the thing. We ultimately, the experiment, certainly not because of our theory. Our theory only made it sort of like into PRL. The experiment with us, the paper made it then later into Nature Physics. I'm showing this because I'm aware that many of these experimentalists nowadays have artists preparing wonderful figures in the hope that they will be chosen to be on the title page. I mean, if you look at that, I think you certainly will agree that we made no specific effort to be chosen to be on the title page. And I'm also showing this because some editor invented the sentence. I mean, there are these bosons relaxing. And so that they produce the title of bosons chilling out. I mean, if you look at it at, from a statistical physics point of view, you start at a pure state, and then you ultimately get into a state which is still pure, but subsets of it are mixed thermal states. And actually, you can look at the temperature. What these guys do is they heat up a lot. They are anything, they do anything but chill out. But so this definitely was not invented by us. But sort of like what got us excited is that these people, these experimentalists, were able of like after we had predicted that there might be nice physics, and I will walk you through that in a second, they were actually able to really see how, say, on an odd site where there were zero atoms beforehand, like how this would relax to 0.5 with some oscillations because these atoms slosh forth and back. And this, these are really interacting systems. They can tune the U quite freely. We will see that in a second. And we are really talking about thermodynamically large systems. In fact, this is a bit cheating. The systems really are lots of one-dimensional systems of, say, 100 atoms each. But this is a system size which, for DMRG and time evolution, is easily within reach. The problem is another one. So what of course, in this world of these quantum simulators, what people have to do is they have two things. On the one hand, the experiment has to be better than the best classical simulation. Otherwise, you don't need, I mean, these Bloch experiments, they cost around 2 to 3 million euros or something. And I mean, our simulations were done on comparatively cheap workstations and clusters. So why do you actually need the experiment? Well, because it can go beyond this classical barrier we have due to entanglement. On the other hand, these are very complicated experiments. How do you know that they actually simulate what you think they are simulating? So you need validation or certification or whatever the QI people call this nowadays. And here, so what we started out with is, I mean, this is the interaction strength. There are various values of U. They call T, our Hubbard model T, they call that J in atomic physics. So it's not the the magnetic J. This is our T. They use T for time, you know, very weird. And there's traps which keep this thing confined, and there are experimental parameters. And so like what you can see is that up to the time scales we can reach, the agreement between, let's say, look at this curve, there are some deviations here, which however we understand. The agreement between theory and experiment for really interacting many body problem is really very good. And so we really believe that they are doing the thing we think they do, in particular as there's not a single free fit parameter involved in the entire calculation. So there was nothing, no fudge factor available. It's sort of like pure, you have these Vanier orbitals, which are very well known in this cold atom business. You can really work out all the parameters. You plug them into the simulation, and that is what comes out. On the other hand, they can go way beyond what we could simulate. Now, honestly, I must say, I find this relaxing density a bit boring. So what we also did, just for fun, because we didn't think that would be of any importance, we calculated also numerically the nearest neighbor correlators. The real part is the buildup of quantum correlations in the chain, because originally it was a product state. So it all starts out at zero, and depending on the interaction strength, and we really have no limitation to what U we take, we only have limitations to how far we get in time, as I explained to you. You see the saturates, and the saturation value strongly depends on U. And this, so the saturation value as a function of U is plotted here. So there's a non-monotonicity, there's a 1 over U behavior, which one can understand easily. Up to today, no one really understands how this curve plays out up here, but at least we can calculate it. And this is the current, how this sloshing of the particles, how this relaxes. Okay, anyways, we had calculated that and thought just for fun. And then these guys were actually able, let me jump the currents for reasons of time. These guys were actually able to measure that, surprisingly. And you see, this was our prediction. the buildup of quantum coherence as a function of interaction strength, which is also a sign, because this is built up against the cohering tendency. So this really shows how well coherent the experiment is. And this is what they found in the experiment. So look at this. Look at this. We were extremely excited when we first got this curve from these guys. So, yes, yeah, that will be the story of the next slide. Of course, there is a meaning to the absolute numbers. And so sort of like then the next thing we did is, of course, we put them into the same units. These are the units. They have this visibility. There's something, the typical quantum optical definition of visibility. We redid our, we reworked our numbers into visibility, and then you get this. And then our excitement died down a little bit because you see the experimental signal is much stronger than the theoretical one. First, of course, we had hoped there was a factor two, which we had missed out, you know, the usual things. But no, there was no factor of two. And the bad thing is, you know, if theory gives a stronger signal than experiment, you can always try to bullshit your way out by saying, you know, there's impurities, there's this, there's that, there's experimental imperfections, and so on and so forth. But here, A, it's A, the wrong way around, and perhaps it's also a bit too large, because you may know that these ultra-cold atom experiments are really very precise. And then, sort of like it turned out, and then I really had this idea that sort of like we were really not comparing the same things, because there is a very weak confining trap which keeps these atoms together. For these densities, it made absolutely no difference whether we used these traps or not. I mean, you could also say I put particles in a box at the same density, or I keep them confined by this weak potential. It really didn't make any difference. And so we felt, well, if it doesn't make any difference at the center for the density, why should it make a huge difference for B dagger B on the bond at the center? I mean, this would be a reasonable expectation. And our original calculation for fun did it in a box because we didn't know what the trap would be. And anyways, we just wanted to find out. And then it turned, then we redid the calculation with the real trap. And then it turned out this dramatically changes everything. So first of all, this is sort of like the long time outcome. So this is what we had predicted for a special value of U around. I mean, you would have to find out. It's sort of like around here, say 5. Probably this was 5. This is what we had predicted as the long time result. This is what they had found as the long time result. And now sort of like they had, of course, the measurement how this builds up, and now we recalculated how this whole thing builds up. And you see, of course, at some point, both experiment and theory get a little bit imprecise, but nevertheless, you see that this follows this curve very well. We are talking about a strongly interacting problem of 100 or so particles as they evolve in time. And the reason for that physically is ultimately very simple to understand. If you have this confining potential as a parabola instead of a box, sort of like you will have a density profile which looks a little bit like this. The particles can wander up the potential, which they cannot do in the infinite box. And where do they get the energy from? Well, if you look at the expression for the kinetic energy, you see you can gain potential energy by making these expectation values bigger, because then this gets lower. So the entire thing behind that story is these particles steal kinetic energy, which shows up in an increase of the nearest neighbor correlations in order to spread out further. That's the entire story behind it. But what was sort of like the message for us is that both experiment and theory in that field are now at a precision that you can sort of like this incredibly weak trap. I mean, if you look at the slide before, you say, could perhaps remember that there are extremely small numbers for this trap. It's not like this. It really looks like that. That really, that we are extremely sensitive to that, and we can calculate that. So this is sort of like, I just wanted to show this. I mean, there's of course lots of physics questions you can now ask about this problem. I just wanted to show you what you can do with such a code that is able to do time evolution. Something where I felt this might be appropriate, I mean, you do not have neutron flux here. There's no reactor here. No. So, but you have high fields. I mean, you have high fields because many of these people who are interested, say, in spin chains, they do, I mean, Oak Ridge has one of these high flux reactors, Grenoble has one. But the point is, many of these, in the past, when you were measuring a structure function by neutron scattering, you were interested in the peaks. That's all you could resolve. In the meantime, in these reactors, the flux has become so strong that you can really think about the line shape of the lines which you get. And this is, for example, a result obtained by Proholm's people, I think many years ago. This is a spin 1/2 chain where one can see the lower edge of the spin-on continuum, which is delimited by these lines here. Energy as a function of momentum. These are typical results. And now it's becoming so precise that you really can cut across here and try to extract the physics which is in there. The problem is that usually these experiments are at the temperature of, say, 4 Kelvin, liquid helium, and the energy scales of these chains, the interaction. Now, this is the exchange interaction J. This is something which may be of the order of 10 Kelvin. And now this brings me to the high magnetic field lab here. Why are they interested in such stuff? When people, for example, first started looking at these Haldane chains, they would be looking at experimental compounds where the exchange interaction was of the order of, say, 1,000 Kelvin or so. This, however, means that switching on a magnetic field sort of like doesn't allow you to see much of the interesting physics because as a rule of thumb, 1 Kelvin corresponds to 1 Tesla. So what you want is you want spin chains with a much smaller exchange coupling so that your reasonably achievable magnetic fields actually bring in magnetic fields as a physics. So you want that. On the other hand, that means if you compare these guys, that the typical ground state calculations or zero temperature calculations are not worth it. They will miss out part of the essential physics. So motivated by that, you may wonder, how can you do finite temperatures with matrix product states? And in fact, this is a variant of the theme of time evolution. This is why I'm talking about it right here. Namely, it's built on a technique which is used a lot in quantum information theory. And before that, I just had a look at an old mathematical physics book by Tiring from the 60s, 70s. He writes a lot about that stuff. It's just a mathematical physics book. So as a student, I didn't understand what he was talking about. So it means that you can write any mixed state can be written as a pure state of a larger system, namely the physical system itself, plus a copy of it. And the density operator is achieved by taking this pure state and tracing out the auxiliary degrees of freedom. And this allows you to do finite temperature dynamics simply by doing the time evolution of a pure state in this enlarged state space. And so this is now this purification technique in a mathematical form. Let's assume you have the density operator in its eigenbasis, then it has this form. Then you copy your physical system again, not the state, the system. So if I had 100 spins, I put there another 100 spins. They would form the auxiliary system Q. I put the same state there on Q, and write this with the square root of rho as the pure state on the larger system. And then if you work out the reduced density operator on P, you see this this gives you back immediately the reduced density operator of your physical system. So, and then, of course, if you want to do expectation values over the physical density operator, the reduced of the density operator, you write it in the usual way. Then you write the reduced density operator as this trace over the pure state projector. Then you shuffle around because trace is cyclical. and then you end up that everything looks like for a pure state just on a larger system. And the time evolution you do as before. You do the time evolution with the von Neumann equation on the density operator. You write the density operator as the trace over the auxiliary system. Now this acts on the physical system. This acts on the auxiliary system. So you can pull out the trace to the front and you see you trace over the projector of a time evolved state. And the time evolved state is just now the same time evolution as we had beforehand, but on an enlarged system. So in that sense, you can do time evolution. The problem is, of course, you have to get started somewhere. How do I find a pure state representation of a general rho? Because if I have rho in that representation, I don't need all that stuff. I can go analytically from here. So the question is, how do I actually construct that?
Sorry, before you go on.
Yeah. You need that. You need that because if you carry out this trace over the auxiliary degrees of freedom, if you don't have one, I mean, what you need is you need one state here each to match one state here. Otherwise, you cannot reproduce this object here. And in general, I mean, this will be, of course, there will be as many states here as is the dimension of the physical system. And this is why your copy needs to be as large.
Does it have to have all the complications of interactions on it?
Sorry?
Does it have to be an interacting copy, or can you make it a non-interacting
copy? Actually, it just needs to be the same physical object. So 100 spins are replaced, are sort of like added, you add another 100 spins, but these 100 spins need not interact. Actually, as such, they have no Hamiltonian. If you look at it here, you could write that this is h times 1, so this means, of course, you do anything you want. Actually, it's a smart choice, as it turns out, to give them a dynamics, which is opposite, is simply the minus t dynamics of the physical system. This turns out to reduce entanglement dramatically, which you generate in this situation. Sorry, I think I was just... Okay. Thanks. So now the nice thing is that for thermal states, it's very easy to construct this pure state. Namely, you write e to the minus beta h in this very deep form. You split it up into two. You insert the identity in between. You have to be able to write the identity as a matrix product state. That's very simple. I will not go through the construction here, but this is almost trivial. And then you see your reduced density operator simply given by producing this state is actually the maximally entangled state you can write down. You do an imaginary time evolution up to beta over 2, and then you trace the environment, and then you have your reduced density operator. Of course, you will not do that. Typically, we'll just take this object and then continue with a real-time evolution to do whatever you want to do here. And I mean, I just want to advertise that there's lots of way of improving that because you have this, what Kevin Ingerson asked, you have this degree of freedom in, do you give the Q a dynamics of its own? And if you do that in a smart way, you keep entanglement growth at bay. I mean, this actually means, it's a subtle issue, but just want to mention it, that you can do that. Okay, all this is very nice, and I could show you further curves here. Perhaps I do that, yeah, it will be after those slides. It turns out, and this will be important for many of the applications where you're interested in spectral functions, is if you want to calculate a spectral function, there have been many techniques in the MPS business which calculate them directly, say, in the K omega space. There's the Lanczos vector method, going back to Karen Hallberg in the mid-90s. It's like what you do in ED, the Galliano-Balsiero method. You can do something which is called the correction vector method, where you directly calculate the resolvent 1 over H minus omega. This also runs under the name of dynamical DMRG. This creates confusion with time-dependent DMRG. These methods are, Lanczos is very fast but inexact. This correction vector method is very precise but very slow. We developed in two steps, 2011 and 2014 or 15, two variants of using Chebyshev polynomials for spectral functions. The 2014 or 15 version of the Chebyshev polynomials is certainly at the moment the most efficient way of calculating spectral functions. I'm not aware of any better one at the moment, but it turns out ultimately it's easier to do something else. Namely, you do your C dagger on a state, you do your time evolution, you do a C, and then you get a Green's function of X and T, and then you do your Fourier transforms. I mean, sort of like standard fare. The problem is you can make systems relatively large in DMRG, sort of like 100 or whatever, 200 sites, so that's not really the problem, or even more. You are killed much earlier by the problem that you have to transform to omega with a limited amount of T. That, of course, will limit your frequency resolution quite dramatically. And then you can do all sorts of protoning kernels and this and that, but it doesn't really get you out of this issue at all. So what we developed around 2009 is something really stupid, which is actually from the numerical recipes, and engineers know this and more advanced schemes for the last few decades, just physicists have not been using it that much, is the quite outrageous claim to say that we have a bunch of data points. This may be points out of a time series, for example. And I claim that a point in this time series is simply a linear combination of p previous data points, say the last 10 or 20. Of course, this only makes sense as we can always say that. Of course, the important point is that the coefficients of this linear ansatz, they do not depend on where you are actually in the time series. So what you then can do is, if you believe me, that sort of stuff, that you say, well, I have the data which I can rely on, that part of the time series. I take my available data to find out which coefficients AI fit best to my claim. I mean, this is relatively simple. And then once I have found the AIs which are fitting best for the time series which I have, I use this to predict into the future. Because it's a linear ansatz, it's called linear prediction. Okay, and then of course I can go on as long as I like. The question is just whether it's worth anything. And well, here you see what you get. Here, this was the transverse easing model. We went into momentum space and then predicted S of k and t as a function of t. This can be done exactly also. So what you have here is, well, the lines are for various momenta are the exact results. DMRG went up to here, sort of. We trained our data, basically, we trained the prediction on the data in this region to avoid short time effects. And then we predicted, and you see it's nicely on top of each other. And here's the error. And here you see very small scales, 10 to the minus 8, 10, 12, something like this. And it works, it seems it works extremely well at this point. And this was basically, let's pick the red curve at various betas, 10 and 50. This dotted line, which you see down here, was the best which one could do beforehand. And now with this prediction, sort of like you get the curve with the dots here, and you can compare to the exact solution, which is exactly on top of what we have achieved. I mean, simply extending the time domain by a factor of 10 increased our frequency resolution also by a factor of 10, so that we could really obtain these line shapes very precisely. Actually, what you can see here for a more recent experiment with Bella Lake, where sort of like was it 150 Kelvin, so this was even done at finite temperature. This is their spin-on spectrum for a spin 1/2 chain. And so like now you cut across it and you look at the intensity shape, the line shape. And sort of like you have the experimental data in red, and blue was the best competing theory, and black is what DMRG produces. So this really works extremely well to predict the experimental data in that setup. Question is, of course, when does this work? Is there a miracle at work here? Well, there is not, in the sense, and this is why I predicted S of K and T and not G of X and G of X and T, where I could say, well, let's predict that in Fourier transform later. It only works for special time series. And if you work out the mathematics, you find this ansatz is good at predicting the superposition of exponential decays with oscillations. And if you look at a momentum space Green's function, I mean, I think all of you guys are very familiar with objects of that kind. What you basically see is if this generates a simple pole structure, then this ansatz will work extremely well, because I just take that back. So like, let's assume the sigma generates a single pole at omega I eta. Then I would be able to predict this with a single coefficient in my linear prediction. If you have more poles, then you need more. And interestingly enough, in this spin 1/2 problem, you don't have single poles, you have an entire branch cut. But it seems that with 10 or 15 of poles, you can mimic this entire branch cut so well that you can predict the experiment with that accuracy. So this can be a very powerful technique to predict results in time, but you really have to know what you're doing. Okay, now finally we get to the, and this will be now very short because there's not that much to be said about it actually. Finally, we get to what people originally called DMRG. Because DMRG is nothing but a variational search for the ground state of a Hamiltonian within an MPS ansatz space. So you give me, say, a dimension which my MPS is allowed to have, and I want to find the one that approximates the ground state best. So what does it do? It minimizes this expression. I put that into a Lagrangian multiplier formulation. So what I have to do is, if I represent this graphically, I have this object here. This is psi h psi minus lambda psi psi. I have to minimize this tensor network, which I have written down here. Now, the problem is, if you want to extremize that, you find out very quickly that this is multilinear, because all these variables are multiplied to each other. This is nasty. So what you do instead is a time-proven mathematical technique, is that it's called alternating least squares in other contexts, is that you say, I minimize this variationally with respect to one matrix. This turns it into a linear problem. So taking the, so I have to take the partial derivative with respect to one matrix or its components. In the graphical picture, this just corresponds to removing it. So this is now what I have to do. If I solve this problem, then the object that is here, which is just the complex conjugate of the object here, this is the better matrix I was looking for, which brings me down in energy. So this is a generalized eigenvalue problem, because this matrix here is surrounded by all this stuff here. It now kicks in if your work, as I told you to do, always in this mixed normalization matrix product state formulation, then you may remember there was this picture that these would all contract to single lines. They would all disappear. And then this problem turns into a simple eigenvalue problem of the optimal condition number. So that's what you have to solve. Now, this object here will have dimension, say, let's take a matrix of dimension 1,000, which is not untypical. So this would be 1,000 times 1,000 times, say, Hubbard model 4. This will be a problem of dimension 4 million times 4 million. There is lots of sparsity in the problem, which you can enhance by using quantum numbers. Explaining quantum numbers here in detail, I don't have the time, but in the tutorial you will see what quantum numbers do for you in terms of speed. And then if someone is interested, we can, of course, deal with this during the tutorial. So you do that. So this, you find the matrix which gives you the lowest energy here for this expression. Now, of course, optimizing a single matrix will not really solve the problem for you. So what you have to do is you have to do this for all of them. I mean, here it's the same thing written in nasty mathematical expression with all the indices. But what you have to do is, of course, you have to do this for any matrix. So what you do is you start your DMRG algorithm with a random matrix product state or a good guess, which you may have. Then you pick this hot site where you say, here do I optimize my matrix by solving the problem which we had on the last slide. And then I have to do this everywhere. So I sweep this hot site basically forth and back. I could, of course, also do it randomly here, 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 and here. But the reason why you do it in this way is because this allows you, as you have, if you remember this compression algorithm, you basically, if you do this compression, you can keep the normalization by sweeping forth and back through the system. So this is what you do. In this way, you maintain this mixed normalization, which ensures that you have a simple eigenvalue problem, not a generalized one. And then you improve each matrix, each of the many, many A matrices. And because you will not be converged after the first sweep through the system, you do this again and again and again and again until the whole thing doesn't move anymore. And it really depends on the problem you are looking at, whether this works fast or whether you have to do this many, many times. So, and to see whether you are converged, one way of doing this is, of course, to look at the variance of the energy, which tells you whether you are in an eigenstate, because these algorithms have a tendency to pull you into the ground state. You can reasonably rely on that it's actually the ground state. That's not such a big problem. Okay, so as time has run out, I will not be able, unfortunately, to go through. I will just mention topics which you can then, for example, find in this review, is, of course, how do you build such a Hamiltonian as a matrix operator? This is, of course, the one ingredient that was still missing, but perhaps this is easier read than explained on the blackboard. Okay, this is just showing that. As a last thing, because the plan was just to give you an idea how we move on from here, I would take a few more minutes, three or four, to give you a glimpse of two-dimensional problems. And then I would like to move on after the break to the tutorial. And during the tutorial, there will be parts like simple calculations which will run fast. And then there will be calculations which take a longer time. And during that longer time, while you're waiting for your results, those of you who don't want to get out into the sun can be entertained with explanations of how to use DMRG as a DMFT solver, because this will be the calculation that will be running in parallel so that you actually know what your laptop is currently doing. Okay, so just as a brief remark, is one model that has kept us busy in magnetism for decades now is the Kagome lattice. It's already nasty as a classical model, but we have not been able to find its quantum ground state for decades now. And the question is, what can DMRG do about it, or matrix product states? So one way of doing this is to map the 2D system to a one-dimensional system, which then, of course, has long-range interactions, because these guys talk to each other, but on the chain, they sit very far apart. The reason why DMRG doesn't work so well was originally attributed to these long-range interactions, but that's not the problem, actually. The problem is area law. The area law means that the entanglement grows linearly with the size of the cut. Now, if you cut across the system along here, you have many, many matrices encoding the state. So you cut across many bonds. And this means, if you work it out, because they multiply each other, that this exponential growth of the matrix dimension exactly matches the linear growth of the entanglement you have here. This is no problem. The problem arises along the second dimension, where a single bond in the matrix product state has to carry the entire entanglement between the left and the right half of the system. And therefore, it will get exponentially large. So what people do in that business is we all look at cylinders. They are in this direction, we work at the long direction, which is no problem. We work with open boundary conditions. DMRG and MPS do not like periodic that much because this creates extra entanglement. But this, as these cylinders are not very wide in their circumference, you have to use periodic boundary conditions because otherwise you're stuck with boundary effects. So this is sort of like the systems you're really looking at, and your MPS sort of winds around it. And what you then see is, if you do that, I mean, this is sort of like, this was from 2012. Now we can do much, much better. We used a fully SU2 invariant DMRG code. The competing groups all had U1. At that time, we used 3,800 SU2 states, which corresponds to 16,000 states if you do not use if you do not use SU2. We had a circumference, because the lattice is a bit weird, a circumference up to 17, and then sort of like we really could determine the energy quite well. Actually, what can we do now roughly? Much more.
Due to the exponential growth, I wouldn't expect.
No, I mean here at that, because the correlation length in Kagome is very short, one would probably not be interested in making that bigger, but the accuracy higher. Yeah, so that's something one can do here. In how there are, I mean, if you use K, probably that might help. Anyways, that's a different. Yeah. So in the Hubbard model, there would be additional tricks one can play, which make you go to much, much higher values. But anyways, so like, what I wanted to show as the one result, which I think got people most excited at that time, is that there is this, one knows from field theory that if there's a topological spin liquid as a present as a state, there must be a negative contribution to its entanglement, which is size independent. It's the so-called topological entanglement entropy, TEE. And sort of like this was the first determination of this topological entanglement entropy, which was clearly negative from what we concluded, that this the Kagome actually has a topological spin liquid as its ground state. One can also maybe argue that it's a so-called C2 spin liquid, but that does not necessarily follow from this data. It's perhaps the most conclusive result which you can conclude from that, but it's not perfectly sure. But no other method actually was able to calculate that. In all fairness, I have to say that more recently there was a paper which claims, no, it's not a topological spin liquid of that sort with a gap, but it's a gapless spin liquid. All this is sort of like at the borderline of what you can just do numerically at the moment. So we will have to see what comes out. Debates of that sort help you to get lots of citations, so I don't see it necessarily negatively. But I would like to conclude at that point and just say that in the break, sort of like while you're waiting for your long calculations, we would then talk a little bit about DMFT and DMRG. But for the time being, I'm done, and of course open for more questions if you are still alive. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Is there a reason you chose that snaking pattern as opposed to, say, like a space filling curve pattern or some
They're sort of like, this was a grossly simplified pattern. The actual pattern that one uses for the Kagome, well, because the lattice is already quite complicated, is actually a much more windy affair. And there is a reach, there is a reason to that. What you would like to choose as your pattern, and actually in our more advanced DMFT applications where you really have a very weird topology where you don't really know which sides should be close to each other. Somehow there we do that by quantum informational means that actually select the order for us. Here you would say you want those sides that are strongly entangled, you want those close to each other. And in that model with its short range interactions, typically these are the sides that sit close to each other anyways. But there is actually, this is a question, I mean, and we are reordering such things. And if at that time when these calculations were done, we didn't really understand how to do that. And so like everyone else, we went along several well-defined paths for the Kagome, which the community has agreed upon also for comparing stuff. And then of course what you want is that the results should be hopefully the same and not depend on the path you choose and to some limitations they actually are. But this is a deep issue. Here it's, I mean, on a Heisenberg chain, of course, typically you will put the neighboring sites together. They will be closest entangled. But in a, say, in quantum chemistry, where you have orbitals of a molecule and you really don't know which molecule is strongly entangled with which other one, this reordering business becomes absolutely essential to make your code work. Yeah, I mean, if you are stupid and your most strongly two entangled orbitals are sitting on the extreme ends, this information has to be propagated through all other sites. You don't want that.